Good morning, A.I.T. We're here in studio today to talk about Apple and other multi-billion dollar corporations, specifically the issues surrounding the dilemma of cheap electronics. First of all, let us welcome here today to discuss these implications, our Asian news correspondent, Trisha Takinawa.
Thanks, Brian. Delighted to be here.
Let us begin by saying that in the last quarter alone, there have been over 64 million iDevices sold. Clearly the world loves Apple products. What we don't hear much about is the manufacturing process behind them. Trisha, can you tell us some more?
No problem, Brian. Foxconn Technology of N High Precision Industry is the largest electronics manufacturer in the world and has helped Apple achieve these sales figures. Foxconn has a workforce consisting of over 1,200,000 employees who work 12-hour shifts, 6 days a week. In 2007, within 3 months of the iPhone release, over 1 million units were moved. In that same period, Foxconn assembled over 200 million units. With a workforce this large, Foxconn contribute to over 40% of the world's electronic devices.
Joining us live now from our studios in Shenzhen, China, via a satellite video link, is former Foxconn employee, Yoshi P. Mitsu. Mr. Mitsu, good evening.
您好.
That means hello. Good evening and good morning to you alone.
Firstly, tell us what it was like to be an employee at Foxconn, Mr. Mitsu.
Well, I started in 2010 at a recruitment drive where almost 2,000 people were applying for jobs. Because of Apple's demand, over 80% of us were offered a position. I worked in a production line making the glass retina displays for iPhone 4S. To be honest, it's not very good. We worked in very small spaces. One shift began at 7 a.m., and the other at 7 p.m., so I worked for a very long time every day. The pay was good compared to the local standards. I earned 106 yen a day.
In our currency, that is only 13 euros a day, which is a really low wage in comparison. Reports in the past have shown workers have even committed suicide over their low pay rate.
Can you give us any more information on these suicides? It must have been awful working there for such extreme measures to be taken by your co-workers.
The suicides at Foxconn were a tragedy, and I don't think it's fair to attribute any one cause to people reacting that way. It is a high-pressure, low-profile job. Some people reacted badly to it. To me, the conditions are much better than anywhere else, and I feel they are being shown in the wrong light in the news.
All right, interesting. Thank you for your time, Mr. Mitsu. Well, Trisha, what do you think of that?
To be honest, Brian, I think the statistics speak louder than the words of an employee who could have possibly been threatened to keep the truth from the media. Let's take a look at some facts regarding this matter. It's Foxconn's policy that anyone who agrees to interviews will be investigated for criminal activities against them. Workers are treated to minimal human rights. 6 to 8 people are forced to share cramped dorms, costing an average 13 euros a month. Conditions are so adverse that employees have even committed suicide while under contract there.
Foxconn asks employees to sign a no-suicide pledge and has also forced them to sign a contract which states they or their family members will not sue them over a death or injury.
And now, let us hand you over to our senior analyst, with a very special guest, to discuss Apple's motivation behind choosing Foxconn as their primary manufacturer. Hi Maria, can you explain to us Apple's mentality in choosing China as its development center for its iDevices, given these circumstances?
Well Trisha, I know someone who can explain it better than I ever could. Let me introduce the late ex-CEO and co-founder of Apple, Mr. Mechanical Steve Robot Jobs.
You can call me iSteve. Allow me to explain. Apple does not produce custom products and so it does not need to deliver quickly. The products are standard and mass-produced. Apple does not change its assortment that often. The big issue for us was supplier availability, engineering changes and flexibility.
Right. Its production volumes and often unpredictable engineering changes require manufacturing flexibilities and engineering capabilities on a scale that is simply not available in the USA. Was that correct, Steve?
It was correct and still is correct, folks.
Apple's executives then and now say that going overseas is really their only option. But is it really, Steve?
Let me put it this way. When I was working as CEO, we needed to attach a new screen model to the iPhone 4S. And boy, did we need it quick. 8,000 employees in China could be and were gathered at the last minute to attach these new glass screens to the iPhones. They worked 12-hour shifts, and within any 6 hours, the plant was producing 10,000 iPhones a day. No American plant can match that speed and flexibility. Period.
Fascinating. But if most electronic companies make use of these foreign facilities, how then does that affect employment opportunities in the West?
Well, Brian, allow me to answer that. Well, again, using Apple in particular as an example. They employ around 43,000 people in the US and 20,000 in other Western countries. However, the 700,000 people who work for Apple's contractors build and assemble iDevices. These are all jobs which are not available in the U.S., Jared Bernstein, U.S. economic advisor, even had this to say.
Mega corporations like Apple is an example of why it's so hard to create middle-class jobs in the U.S. today.
So it seems the American government clearly feel companies such as Apple are to blame for the decline in the American production industry.
So Maria, and, I guess, Steve. When were the first signs that the electronic manufacturing industry in America first started to decline?
Unfortunately, Steve has just malfunctioned and was taken away by an Apple Care representative.
My name is Bora. I like it.
Well, Tricia, in 1995, Apple's facility near Sacramento employed more than 1,500 workers. Those who worked their way up the ranks were earning salaries up to $50,000, however. The electronics industry was changing. One focus was improving manufacturing. Modernization caused mid-wage jobs to disappear. Even workers with college degrees were not safe. Routine tasks were sent abroad. Robotics with the ability to assemble products gradually replaced the employees working there. As overseas operations expanded, the need for skilled workers declined. Machines were becoming mainstream, and as a result, employment opportunities for electronic manufacturing slowly disappeared. Betsy Stevenson sums it up pretty well with,
"Companies once felt an obligation to support American workers, even when it wasn't the best financial choice. That has disappeared. Profits and efficiency have trumped generosity."
Well, there's no arguing with the figures and statistics presented. Tricia, what do you think? Do you agree with Apple's work ethic?
I think it's fair to say that Apple is the poster child for the conditions at Foxconn because of its size. I think if you put the shoe on the other foot and scrutinize other companies, you will see they are also guilty of less than humane working conditions, so Apple aren't alone in this.
Having looked at Apple's ideology from a few angles now, I think it's fair to say it's a complicated issue. Consumers want good, reliable products at speeds which are unavailable in the Western world. A choice is going to have to be made between hard labor or slow produce, soon.
In the end, it will be us, as consumers, that will have to make that choice. But for the foreseeable future, I don't think that is going to change.
Thanks, Tricia. Well, that's all we have time for here in AIT's live studio. We hope you enjoyed our broadcast, and wish to thank you all for tuning in. You stay classy, Athlone. Break it down, you saucy links.
It's getting crazy up in this party.
Your girl admits that we the shit. FRESH, we fresh. GEF, that's right, we dip. We dip.
definite. BEP, we reppin' it. So turn me up.
And now, Ollie Williams with the weather in Athlone.
It's gonna rain!